En route from Mexico City to Lake Chapala, we pause to admire the famous Bandera Monument at Toluca, built as a modern tribute to the flag of Mexico. This unique monument symbolizes the strong national feeling that has been developed in Mexico during the past generation, a generation in which modern education and social equality have become the unifying principles of the Republic. And for this, we salute the illustrious flag of that country and say, Viva Mexico! Over 5,000 feet above sea level and not far from the city of Guadalajara lies Lake Chapala, the largest body of fresh water in Mexico and one of that country's most popular pleasure resorts. Lake Chapala covers an area of about 1,400 square miles, and its picturesque shoreline provides a splendid setting for a colorful assortment of houses, varying from simple cottages to more elaborate dwellings. Chapala is the word that the Indians use to describe the soft lap of the waves against the shore. The lake is noted for a delicious species of fish which bite best at dawn or twilight and provide an excellent alibi for romanticists who would choose these romantic hours in which to do their fishing. The Rio Grande de Santiago, the largest river in Mexico, flows from Lake Chapala over a broad ledge, forming the famous Falls of Huanacatlan, the Niagara of Mexico. This mud-brown water contains a valuable clay material which is used by the numerous pottery shops in and around Guadalajara, specializing in unusual specimens of pottery, all handmade by Indian craftsmen. Although the early Spanish settlers taught the Indian potters some of the secrets of their trade, the general form and application of their work is about the same as it was before the arrival of the Europeans. Perhaps the chief Spanish contribution was the art of glazing, which has largely replaced the dull finish that characterized the original designs of the Indians. The Indians south of the Rio Grande were a highly developed people, and many of the arts in which they excelled are still practiced by their direct descendants in Mexico. The music and romance with which Mexico is so highly endowed, however, must be attributed to Spanish influence, and nowhere in that picturesque land is it more generously lavished than at Xochimilco, a few miles from Mexico City. Wherever we go in this musically enchanted land, we find gaily dressed mariachis rendering the typical music of their country. The floating gardens of Xochimilco were constructed by the Aztec Indians long before the conquest of Mexico. And although they no longer float, they are still a paradise for the flower lovers who patronized the descendants of the Aztecs. Blending harmoniously with the color and music of this romantic region are the costumes of the ever-present mariachis, who are at their best when playing for floral processions such as this one. Almost every region in Mexico has festive costumes for both men and women, which in form and decoration are distinct from those of all other districts. Oddly contrasting with the floral procession is this so-called pole dance, an ancient Indian ritual to the Aztec cycles of time. The principal performers are called Los Voladores, or birdmen, and they are dressed as birds who are believed to be capable of flying from the top of a pole into the spirit world if they so desire. The pole is about 100 feet in height, and the stunt of the birdmen is to jump from the top with rope tied to their ankles, unwinding as they descend. The preparation for this thrilling event is a most important procedure, as the ropes must be wound around the top of the pole in such a manner as to unwind without tangling. Competing with the birdmen are the Quetzals, who perform on this so-called Wheel of Death, another strange demonstration as old as the bird dance, and equally as important in the minds of the Indians, although its true significance is obscure. It takes a great deal of courage to leap from the pole, and there is danger that a man may be killed if the rope slips. And here they go! Like device at the top of a pole acts as a governor, revolving in unison with the pull of gravitation from the weight of the men as their bodies circle downward. Formerly, the ropes used by the voladores were made of ordinary hemp and consequently were not as safe as they should have been, thereby causing numerous accidents. As a matter of fact, in the old days, there was hardly an occasion when at least one of the voladores did not meet his death while performing. And as a result of this, the ceremony is often referred to as the Dance of Death. And so ends the thrilling descent of the birdmen, who have again performed one of the ancient and obscure rites of their forefathers. And it is here that we conclude our glimpses of Mexico. We'll be right back.